who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty, so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, we worship you, God. Who shakes the world with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Brings our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my grace. That you would bear. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy as the Lamb who was slain, worthy as the King who conquered the grave, worthy as the Lamb who was slain, worthy as the King who conquered the grave, worthy as the Lamb who was slain, worthy as the King who conquered the grave, worthy as the Lamb who was slain, worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place. You would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place, oh God. That you would bear my cross. You lay your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me, Lord. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
I noticed the pastor was giving me the cue until my son said, "You're supposed to go." So next week I'll wear my glasses. I'm going to read today from Psalm 121, and it's entitled, God is Our Keeper. I will lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence comes my help. My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in, from this time forth and even forevermore. I would encourage you, if you're having a hard time, if you're struggling, whether your struggle is little or big, whether you keep it to yourself, you share it with other people, at the very least, cry out to God. He is your strength and He will help you. Ultimately, God is our keeper from this day till forevermore.
Amen.
Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for this opportunity to come to church today, to worship you, and to hear your word. I thank you, Jesus, for being in our presence each and every day of the week, in every place that we stand. Thank you that this morning you're in our midst. Help us throughout the week for us to be your light everywhere that we go. That we bring Jesus into every conversation that we have throughout the week. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Would you stand once again? Lord, we love you, Jesus. This is my
resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why into you I run. This is my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come.
You're the great I am, oh God. We worship you.
Jesus, we love you. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and see. I am a child of God. Oh, you split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and see. Oh, I am a child of
stand and see. Oh, I am a child.
know I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and see. Oh, I am a child of God. Oh, I am a child of God. We love you, Lord. Oh, I am your child of God. We love you. I am your child of God. Oh, I am your child of God. I belong to you, Lord Jesus. Oh, I am your child of God.
The Lord is good, isn't he? Amen. Glad to have my beautiful wife up here with me this morning. It's good to see a couple more people have come this morning, and we are ready and prepared for what God has for us. I know we face different things every week, different challenges, different things that we face in this life, but I'm glad that we have someone, the one that is always with us and helping us and leading us and guiding us. At this time, we do our announcements. We have a few things that are coming up, so we're going to take a little bit of time here and cover these for those that are here and those that are online. I do want to mention that you can go to the online bulletin right now and see what I'm talking about right now. So if you go, even if you look up on Gmail, LifePoint Prosser. We're the only LifePoint Prosser church. And so usually on the Google search, we're the first ones that come up. And you can go to the bulletin page and you can see what's going on and what's happening. And so we want to mention things that are coming up that are happening. Also, the scriptures for the message are on there as well. And so I know without having a distraction or whatever you might call it, but if you want, even during service or before service, if you want to look at up the scriptures, you can see that and you can just click on those links that are right on the webpage. And so you can see those and follow along. And I try to have those up before Sunday. And some of you I know that do look at those and read those before service. So, Julie, go ahead and do the ladies' announcements, the different things that are happening there, and then I'll go to the next ones.
Okay. So on Fridays, we actually had our first Friday women's Bible study again. And so what a great opportunity it was just to have some ladies together and get into his word. And it's in Ephesians. And God is so good. He just speaks to us in our hearts, and he just opens our eyes to see more of what he's doing in our lives. And that's at 6:30 on Fridays. So come out, ladies, and be a part. You're welcome to come anytime on Fridays at 6:30.
And what about, do we have prayer for ladies this week? Not this week? Okay. All right. So we'll have the Fridays, and then also Friday mornings, men, we have our prayer and breakfast. And then on the August 25th, we'll have our Saturday men's breakfast where all the men come together. We have a breakfast in the back with a time of fellowship and sharing. So that's going to be on the 25th. But during each week, we do have the Friday mornings at 9 a.m. And so those are what's happening right now. We will have our Wednesday night Bible study starting back up in September. And so after this month, we'll restart that back up after summer. And next week, we do have a special speaker. Terry Davis is going to be with us. He's been recommended by our district overseer, and I got to meet him at camp this last week. And he goes across the country, and he ministers in different churches, but he does something a little bit different. His main ministry is the smaller churches, and he goes throughout, but he raises money to help smaller churches. And so he blesses them in different ways. And so he generally, when he comes, he always wants to help and to bless the church that he goes to. And so he's, when he comes, he is not like a traditional evangelist where they're making money for themselves to be able to travel. He tries to make money and for other churches to be able to help. He's helped with hot water heaters. He's helped with roofs. He's helped with different things as he travels and he ministers at different churches. And he's going to be with us this next week on Sunday morning on the 13th, and also in the evening at 6 p.m. And we'll have two services with him, and then and that will be next week, and then the week after that he'll actually be at Grace Point as well. So he'll be in the area for a couple weeks. So I did want to mention that. That's in your bulletin as well. The parking lot. So the plan is for the 14th. That week we'll be doing that. Last week I misspoke, and so the 14th will be that's the plan. So there's different variables and different things that go on, but that is the intended plan for that to happen. Julie, you want to mention about Right Now Media?
Yeah. So Right Now Media, there's a flyer in your bulletin, and Right Now Media is basically, it's a wonderful resource for Bible studies, online Bible studies throughout all over, different people that are on there. There's a library for even kids, videos. My kids even like to watch the kids section. They have like VeggieTales. They have different kids programs. They have the Bible on there for the kids. And it's just a great opportunity, especially now, to have that resource that you can just, all you have to do is just scan it with your phone with your picture, and this will pop up, and you'll just register with your email, and it will connect, and it's free. Our church pays for it, and it's free to you guys to use and to pass it around. It's free. It's just a great resource for any of those kind of things that you're looking for, topics and stuff, and a great thing for kids too.
Yeah, so that has been available. I know this will make it a little bit easier. So if you take your phone, you can get there, you can register, and you can actually download it. It's kind of just like Netflix or any of those other programs that you can download. You can watch it on your TV. You can watch it on your phone, wherever you go. And through the church, it's provided for each and every one of you to be able to go on there. And we also have some resources that we put on there with our services and different things as well. So that is just this is something for you guys, just for Bible studies and weekly things that you can look up and go there. You can scan that, or you can go to the actual Right Now Media Prosser and find it there. Last week, we had just awesome time at camp the week before, actually. And just if you watched the service last week, you've seen God just moved in great and mighty ways, filling our kids with the Holy Spirit. And God just moved mightily. And in your bulletin, there's some of those statistics there. And just continue to rejoice in the Lord in what he has done. I know I mentioned we were talking a little bit with announcements this week. If you're new online or on here this morning, you can also scan that, or on the website, you can go to guest and you can fill out the online guest info and receive a free gift in the mail. And we just want to say thank you for joining us and being a part, and we just want to connect with you. And so I think that's it for announcements. Would you just pray over the message?
Thank you, Jesus. We just thank you for every opportunity that we get, Father God. God, that you just speak and anoint, Father God, that you would just have your words. Let us have open ears to hear from you, Father Lord. God, that you would just pour in your mighty power, Father God, that you would just come down and all the distractions and everything that's around us. And God, that you just have your way today, Father God. Move in a mighty way, and your message, we would hear from you, Father God. And Jesus, in your mighty name, amen.
Amen and amen. So we are in the book of Jeremiah. And today, we have a place here that you can take some notes, but it is a fire shut up in my bones. And last week, we talked about do not diminish with Jeremiah and this word that he received from God. This word that God told him, don't take away, don't hold back what I want to speak or what I'm going to share with you to share. I want you to tell it with all your heart. I want you to share it. And I don't want you to diminish any word of what I speak. Because there's a temptation many times that we try to, because it's easier and we don't know the response of somebody else, that sometimes we water down things, what God has spoken. And here, God tells Jeremiah not to diminish a word that he speaks. Today, as we're going into this next part, we're going to be in Jeremiah chapter 20. And Jeremiah is faced with, as he has been throughout his ministry, as we learned from in the very beginning when Jeremiah is called as a young man. And Jeremiah, in our first message, if you remember, he was told he had excuses. Excuses why he couldn't do what God was calling him to do. He says, but I am a youth. And God says, don't say that I'm a youth. And he tells him that what he's going to do through Jeremiah and the call upon Jeremiah's life, and that God would give him the words to speak, and that God would be with him, and God wasn't going to leave him, but God was going to be with him all the way through. And I want to tell you this morning, that is one of the most important things. If we grab a hold of something this morning, know that God will never leave us nor forsake us, but he will take us all the way through. And we can depend on him, and we can lean upon him as a strength in our hearts and in our lives. And so this morning, as we are going into this second part, a fire shut up within my bones, the word that is in Jeremiah's heart, a lot of what we're talking about in this book of Jeremiah has to do with the word and the power of the word of God, and that the word was with him and the word was given to him to speak. Now, the words that Jeremiah is challenged with. He's challenged once again. The first last week was challenged not to diminish a word. But this second time, the challenge is to give up completely on sharing what God has given him. And so as we're talking here, as we're sharing here, a fire shut up within my bones, we're going to cover a few things. I'm going to tell a little story here. There was a father and a young lady. As the young lady was driving down the freeway, there had been, I don't know, have you seen any of these storms before that in different parts of the country? I haven't seen them. Sometimes there's tornadoes and there's things that come, and these big weather events that seem like they come out of nowhere. And this young lady was driving with her father, and all of a sudden there was one of those storms that came out of nowhere. The land is flat. There's not anywhere that you can really go to get out of the storm or to leave the storm. And as they were driving, they were going down the road, and the storm begins to come. The winds begin to pick up, and things begin to blow all around. The storm became so intense that it was becoming harder and harder to see. And there was this word that kept coming to her as she was driving from her father, saying, keep on going, keep driving, don't stop. There's something that the father knew that the daughter didn't know, because the father had experienced these storms before. And as the father was telling his daughter, because her father used to drive and drive a truck, and he would experience these things, and he knew exactly what was happening and what was going on. And as she begins to see these cars begin to pull over, these cars trying to find a place, and they end up getting stuck in the storm. And she says, I see everybody else pulling over. I see everyone else getting off the road. Father, should I get off the road? And the father speaks to her and says, no, keep on driving through. She says, Father, the storm is getting more and more intense. It's getting harder and harder to see. And he speaks to her and he says, you're almost through. You're almost through. And she keeps on driving, and she keeps on going as she listens to the father. She's getting scared, and she doesn't know what's going to happen, but she keeps listening to the voice of the father as she's going through this storm. And as he keeps telling her to push on through and to keep going and keep going, she eventually drove right out of the storm. And she gets a distance away from the storm that you could stop, and you could look back and you could see it. The father says, stop. And she stops. And she says, why do we stop right now? And he says, well, we're through the storm. He tells her, I want you to look back and see, because you kept pressing through and you kept going through and you kept listening to me, you made it through the storm. And all the others who gave up behind, they're still there waiting in the storm. Listening to the voice of God, listening to our Father, will get us through every single storm in our life. Every situation, every difficulty. Sometimes in the storm it's hard to see, but we know the one that sees all things and knows all things and can see around the corner, can see what's coming ahead. And as we listen to him, we will be able to get through the storm. Now, I tell this story because Jeremiah is faced with something in the middle as what we could call a storm. As this story that I'm reading, and I'm going to read in Jeremiah chapter 27 through 13, Jeremiah is faced with something where he says that he just isn't going to speak anymore in his name or in the name of the Lord. He says, I am done. I can't do it. He was about and he was ready to give up in the middle of what he was facing. And I don't know about you, but maybe you have felt like giving up. Maybe you've been faced with certain things that you just felt like giving up, and you didn't know what to do, and you're just like, okay, I am tired of the fight. I'm tired of the battle. I'm tired of it. I just am going to stop, and I'm not going to go any further. And this is where Jeremiah and what he was faced with. Now, what I'm going to read to you this morning, and as we're looking at this, this is what is spoken. It is where they place this and in scripture, and how everything is worded and how it said that this is supposed to be in the place where Jeremiah was in stocks. That Jeremiah was being punished and beaten for speaking the word of God. And this is recorded as what he said during that moment and during that time. Now, I don't know about you. I don't know if you have been beaten and put in stocks and made fun of. But Jeremiah was. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but I say this many times. Sometimes we can get on different Bible characters and say, how could you do such a thing? How could you say that you're not going to speak in God's name anymore? We talked about Jonah. We talked about Gideon. We talked about different ones. And sometimes we can get on. I've heard people get on Peter when he goes to be walking on water and he starts to look at the waves. I've heard people say, well, Jesus was right there. Why didn't he just walk to him and trust him? And I don't know about you, but how many have walked on water? Sometimes we can get on people, but sometimes we don't realize the situation either. Jeremiah was faced with something very difficult, beaten, put in stocks. And he's at that moment where he says, I'm not going to do this anymore. He says, I can't do this anymore. So in verse 7, it says, O Lord, you induced me, and I was persuaded. You are stronger than I and have prevailed. I am in derision daily. Everyone mocks me. For when I spoke, I cried out. I shouted violence and plunder because the word of the Lord was made to me. A reproach, a derision daily. Then I said, I will not make mention of him. Nor speak in his name, but his word was in my heart like a burning fire shut up within my bones. I was weary of holding it back, and I could not. I heard many mocking, fear on every side. Report, they say, and we will report it. All my acquaintances watched for my stumbling, saying, perhaps he can be induced. Now this makes sense as he is put in stocks and he's there, that maybe he will learn his lesson. Maybe he will learn his lesson about saying these things about what God was telling him to say. And he says, I can't hold back. I got to do it. But the enemy was saying that maybe as we put all of this pressure on him, maybe if we punish him, that he will stop saying what he's saying. Perhaps he can be induced. Then we will prevail against him and we will take our revenge on him. Verse 11, but the Lord is with me as a mighty, awesome one. Therefore, my persecutors will stumble and will not prevail. They will be greatly ashamed, for they will not prosper. Their everlasting confusion will never be forgotten. But, O Lord of hosts, you who test the righteous and see the mind and heart, let me see your vengeance on them, for I have pleaded my cause before you. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the poor from the hands of the evildoers. Here, Jeremiah is faced with a very serious, difficult situation, however you want to say that. This is after Jeremiah shares about the potter. Does anyone remember the potter and the clay? And here Jeremiah shares about this, but he shares that Israel is to be like a broken vessel, that it needs to be broken so that the potter can begin to reshape and to shape his people into who he had called them to be. Here, as he shares this, he shares it at the dung gate where Jerusalem took all the garbage out of the city. And he shares all this, and then the people get upset with him and they throw him in stocks. Here, because they turned their backs on God, God would allow them to be thrown out because they had become a vessel of dishonor. This was a word of from Jeremiah to Israel at this time. This is Old Testament. This is where God was saying that my people need to serve me. They need to follow me. And they need to wholeheartedly serve me. Jeremiah tells them the truth, that if you don't change your ways, destruction is going to happen. So with all that being said, kind of the background of where we are this morning, my points this morning are I will not make mention, and I'm going to be talking about hurt that clouds the sight of value. Number two, but his word was in my heart, vision and sight restored by the word in our heart. Lastly, resting in the Lord's mighty power. Here as Jeremiah said, I'm done. I can't do this anymore. He said, I will not make mention of him any longer. Has anyone ever known anybody that has said that? I know that there are some that kind of go to the extreme, and it seems like whenever something overwhelming happens, this is one of the first things that you hear come out of their mouth, that I'm done. I'm done with it all. It's over. I'm not going to do this. Sometimes you can hear this in discussions or people that get frustrated or they're upset with somebody. I've heard this at work before. Anyone ever hear it at work? I remember when I was working, I worked at Walmart. How old was I? It was out of high school. And so it was a few years ago. But I worked at Walmart. And they weren't treating their employees very well at the time. And I wanted to do the best job. How many always want to do the best job? That's your personality. You do a good job. You do everything that you need to do. And I worked there for only 3 months. And as I did all that I did as unto the Lord, and I was, God blessed me, and God gave me favor right out of high school. And I gave my 2 weeks notice because of a lot of the things that were happening. And there was a lot of evil stuff actually happening at this Walmart. Believe it or not, bad things happening at Walmart. But they had this group of cashiers. I was a cashier. They had about 8 or 9 of them that said this, I'm done. We're done. Not just one, but we're done. And I'm like, I just started. I'm not done yet. And so I'm the one left. And I was the last cashier, and had all these people start to come through. But they were done. They were done. God gave me favor on that job. I was on, when I gave my 2 weeks notice, when I was called into the ministry, I had two things that God, I knew God was calling me into ministry. And, but also at that same time, they at Walmart, just being out of high school, and I given my 2 weeks notice, you know, this is only the Lord, because they offered me a track to be a management and then going into as a store manager. And so I would have been one of the youngest store managers in Oregon at the time if I would have followed that track. But that's just because of the Lord. I had two decisions to make, and I chose what I knew God had called me to. God moves. God works. God helps. But there are times that we are faced with certain things where sometimes it just feels like it's easier to give up. There are many decisions that we make every day based on this very thing. Sometimes we weigh out what is important. Is it worth it? Anyone ever weigh out a situation or weigh out even going and getting something? I've weighed this out before. How many have ever had a night craving for ice cream? Where you're just like, okay, I need some ice cream. And then you're like, okay, you look in the refrigerator and there's no, or the freezer. I keep mine in the freezer. I don't know about you. But you look in the freezer and you look in there and there's nothing there. So you are faced with a decision of what is more important to you, staying at home, not leaving the house, or wanting or going after what you desire. Here we make decisions every day. I want ice cream, but it's late. But I really want ice cream, but it means I have to get up, I have to get dressed, I have to get in a car, I have to drive, I have to go pay for it, I have to go do this. And many are saying, maybe right now that you're saying, yes, it's worth it. It's worth it. And maybe you have decided that before. Or you try to get someone else to do it. I know nobody's ever done that before. But you go through the process again. Here, there are things that we make decisions if it's worth it or not. If it's worth it or not. This value. Sometimes hurt can cloud what God has called us to. Hurt can cloud what God is wanting to do. Now, I don't know if I'm going to get through all of this message this morning, but I want to say, and I want us to give us a way that we see with Jeremiah that can get us beyond where Jeremiah was, that quitting stage, I give up stage, And I want to share through the word and try to at least get this point this morning. That in the midst of hurt, it can cloud, it can cloud, it can confuse, it can get us from, it can take us from the sight of value, the sight of the importance, the sight of why we are doing what we're doing or getting through, that it is worth it. It is worth the follow Christ wholeheartedly. It's worth it. It's worth it. There's an old song that it will be worth it all. Anyone remember that this morning? It will be worth it all when I see Jesus. Life's trials will seem so small when we see Christ. One glimpse of his dear face, all sorrows will erase. So bravely run the race till we see Christ. Jeremiah lost sight of the worth because of the hurt that he was facing. And I truly believe, of working with people for over 20 years in ministry, I think this is a big one, and even with many that don't return to the church, is that hurt, what has offended, what has hurt you, has clouded the sight, clouded vision, clouded following, clouded what God truly has, because hurt has become and has come to the forefront. And this is exactly what Jeremiah was facing. In the middle of hurt, he said, I will not do it anymore. The hurt, the job of giving bad news to people, beating him, mocking him, being treated like he was the plague. Rejection is a strong discourager, when in reality there is one person that we seek acceptance, and that is through Jesus. When Jesus is happy with us, that is all that should matter. He says, oh Lord, you induced me and I was persuaded. You are stronger than I and have prevailed. He tells us that everyone mocks him. For when I spoke, I cried out. I shouted violence and plunder, because the word of the Lord was made to me a reproach. But he said, I will not make mention of him nor speak in his name anymore. But then something happens. And this is what I want us to grab a hold of this morning. Something happens. Jeremiah goes from quitting to giving up to taking a stand. What Jeremiah didn't know was that he was saying may not seem like it was making a difference because of the rejection. But in reality, what Jeremiah was saying was speaking and going to speak to the future generations of Israel, but is also speaking to us this morning. Point number two, this is what happens. This is what makes the difference. This is what will help us to get beyond hurt and get beyond the things that the weight of the things of what people say. This is what will get us past it. Because he says that he is done, that he's not going to make mention anymore. But then he says this, but his word was in my heart. Vision and sight restored by the word of God that is in our heart. So his word was in my heart like a burning fire, he says, shut up in my bones. I was weary of holding it back. And he says, I could not. What restored his spiritual sight of continuing in the work of the Lord, it was the live word of God that was in his heart. Not in his bones, but it was like a fire in his bones. It was in a place, the most important place, it was in his heart. The placement of the word of God is very important. It doesn't say that it was placed in his mind. It doesn't say that it was placed in his hand. But it was placed in his heart. That is the starting place. That is the deepest, most deep place in a person, of the person of who they are. The word of God was in his heart. It doesn't say his hand. With the Bible, we have Bibles on our phones, right? We have Bibles that we can have. We have access to it anywhere at any time. For many, it's in your hand each and every day, yet this is not the place where it makes the difference. David says in Psalms 119:11, it says, "Your word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you." His word, Jeremiah says, it was where? In his heart, the innermost part of his being. He says, it was in my heart, like a fire shut up in my bones. The word of God is alive. He tried to cover it up. He tried to say, I'm done. I can't do this anymore. He tried to be quiet, but it was something, there was something more powerful than him. That's the truth. The louder than the hurt that he felt. The truth of the word was louder than the hurt that he felt. It was the word of God. The Bible says in Hebrews, the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. When I was a kid, I couldn't get past the truth of the word of God that was in my heart. The word of God is alive. I remember when I was young that there was a time where I said, I don't want to have anything to do with Jesus, with Christianity, with religion. I didn't want to have anything to do with it. And I remember God continuing to speak to my heart. Jesus spoke to my heart because of what my parents taught, because of how my upbringing was. There was the word of God was there. And when I faced those things, I could not get away from the word. 3, resting in the Lord's mighty power. He says, for I heard many mocking, fear on every side. They said, report, and we will report it. Hear all my acquaintances watch for my stumbling, saying, perhaps he can be induced, that we will prevail against him, and we will take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me as a mighty, awesome one. Therefore, my persecutors will stumble and will not prevail. They will be greatly ashamed, for they will not prosper. As Jeremiah was faced with this hurt, what got him through the hurt was the word of God in his heart. The word of God in your heart will make a difference. The word of God being in your heart, being applied to your life, knowing who God is will make the difference. All of this, who we are all around, making fun of him. Fear was on every side of him. They were wanting him to fail, to waver. Thinking being in stocks and beating him was going to destroy him, that he would stop sharing the word of God, that he would come over to the dark side, that he will stumble, that he will fall. And I want to tell you the same thing this morning, that the enemy is defeated, that the enemy has been defeated by the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus has been applied to your life. You belong to him. You don't belong to the enemy. And I want to tell you, but the same tactics that the enemy used on Jeremiah are the same tactics that he will use upon you. He will try to convince you that because and bring all these things and bring this feeling of that I can't do it anymore, that all this hurt and all these things that are weighing upon you, that you just want to give up. There will be things that will come your way, and you'll say, just like Jeremiah, this is too much. I don't want to go through this anymore. But the enemy has been defeated through Jesus Christ. He has no more power over you. And the same thing in the word of God being in Jeremiah's heart is the same word that is in our heart today, that no matter what the enemy says and what the enemy tries to do, that he is defeated. And Jeremiah realizes this through the word of God. They thought that they had him, just like the enemy thought that he had you. And the enemy thought that here, after the word rising in his heart, we see that what these people are trying to do, they are trying to put pressure on Jeremiah to get him to quit. But Jeremiah realizes something through the word of God. They thought that silencing was going to hurt him, stop him from doing what God said. But what they didn't realize, that Jeremiah's heart was still filled with the word of God. as the pressure became, and the pressure came upon him, as they were making fun of him, as they were beating him, as they were mocking him. He says, I am giving up. I can't do this. But then all of a sudden, there was like a fire. The word of God was like a fire shut up within my bones. And I could not stop, but I had to keep going because the word of God was in his heart. And if the word of God is in your heart this morning, it is like a fire that is shut up within your bones. There is no stopping. There's no quitting. I remember even as a young person, after the Holy was filled with the Holy Spirit, there were those times where I felt the same exact thing. And the book of Jeremiah really spoke to me, because I felt this feeling that as much as I tried to avoid it, when God called me to speak, as much as I tried to avoid it, it was like a fire that was shut up in my bones. I couldn't resist. I couldn't stop. It was there, and I had to share what God had given me. Jeremiah realizing this and being able to rest in the words of the Lord and his awesome power, he realized this, and there is something that changes within him. Jeremiah's heart was filled with the word of God. He says, but the Lord is with me as a mighty, awesome one. I want you to get this picture this morning. As he feels like giving up, the word of God in his heart, he feels like there's a fire that is shut up within his bones. And here he says that the Lord is with me as a mighty one. I really believe that the Spirit of God came upon Jeremiah. Therefore, it says, my persecutors will stumble and will not prevail. The word of God and the spoken prophecy, they will be greatly ashamed, for they will not prosper. And I want to tell you the word that he spoke right then and there, that came to pass, because that was a word of the Lord that was in his heart as he began to speak, and he began to say that no matter what the enemy is trying to throw at me, they will not prevail. This morning, as we begin to bring this to a close, Jeremiah said, I will not make mention. There was a hurt that clouded the sight of value. He finds that the word was in his heart. Vision and sight was restored by the word. Vision and sight was restored by the word. And then Jeremiah rests in the Lord's mighty power. Having the word of God in your heart is of utmost importance. The word of God is alive because Jesus is alive. He in your heart will keep you alive in the hardest, most hurtful moments and times that we go through. I know that we've all have faced hurt in one way or another. I know sometimes that hurt can be so overwhelming, especially when we open the door, when people have either ridiculed or even a lot of hurt comes from misunderstandings, but that's another message. The enemy will try to keep you to focus on the hurt. Jesus wants you to focus on his word and the power of his word and who he is. Vision and sight are restored by the word of God in our heart, and we will be able to move beyond hurt in our lives. But for some reason, it almost seems like that we want to hang on to that. Maybe you know what I'm talking about this morning. Maybe you have had a hurt in your life, and everything that it consumes, You see one thing that has nothing to do with what it was, but then it reminds you of that thing. But I know that the Lord wants to set you free this morning. I know that the Word of God can set you free this morning. Would you bow your heads with me? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, We look at the life of Jeremiah. We look at, Lord, the things that he went through and the difficulties that he faced. We see that there was a true hurt, Lord God, as his people, those that he said that were his friends, begin to turn on him, ridicule him, and persecute him. Lord, this man that you called was beaten. He was put in stocks. He faced real hurt, real life challenges. But Lord, we look at this example that you've given us, Lord Jesus. We look at this example, Lord Jesus, knowing, Lord God, Lord, that your word, that you, Lord Jesus, in our hearts and in our life, Lord God. And Lord, we look beyond the Old Testament and go into the New Testament this morning. Lord Jesus, looking and knowing that the blood of Jesus, your blood that was shed for us, Lord God, to bring healing in our lives, not only to our bodies, but Lord God, also to our spirit and also to our soul, Lord God. Lord, that the blood of Jesus, Lord God, bringing healing, Lord, that we can move beyond hurt, that we can move beyond, Lord Jesus, Lord, this overwhelming feeling, Lord God, that these waves that come upon us are telling us to quit. But Lord, your word in our heart, you in our heart, Lord God, is the power to our every situation. Lord, that you are, Lord Jesus, the strength, Lord God, Lord, that gets us through every hurt, every circumstance, and every situation. So, Lord Jesus, right now, Lord God, as we look to your word, as we look to you as, Lord, the healer of our soul, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would heal every heart that is here and every heart and person that is watching online. And maybe there might be one that's watching online that hasn't, Lord, that hasn't become or part of the body or come to church for a while because of a hurt. Lord, I pray right now in your name, Jesus, that you would bring healing to that individual. Lord, that you would bring healing, Lord God. Lord, restore. Restore, I pray. Holy Spirit, minister, I pray right now in Jesus' name. That we, Lord God, Lord, can come together and work together once again, Lord Jesus, Lord, in advancing your kingdom, walking together, serving together, loving you together. Lord, I just pray that you would heal right now in Jesus' name. And maybe the words coming into your heart, well, this or well, that. How can I? Because of this or because of that. Lord, I pray, God, that you would bring healing like only you can do. Lord, that eyes would be shifted upon you, not upon man, not upon a person, not upon a situation, but Lord, placed upon you right now in this moment. And Lord, every moment to come. Lord, we just ask this right now in Jesus' name. Wash over us, I pray. Healing us, I pray, in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you, God, for who you are. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. And Lord, I just thank you for your word. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you're doing right now. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. If you need special prayer this morning, maybe it has to do with getting past a hurt. Maybe it's something else and you just need prayer this morning. I just want to take a moment to give that opportunity. There will be those that will gather around you and pray. Lord, we love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We give you praise and we give you glory. Lord, we just give you praise and we give you glory.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone.